Tibial shaft fractures in adults. The lower leg is made up of two bones, the tibia and fibula. The tibia is the larger of the two bones. It supports most of your weight and is an important part of both the knee joint and ankle joint. Tibial shaft fracture are the most common long bone fracture. In the event of a tibia fracture, the fibula is often broken as well. Tibial shaft fractures are often caused by some type of high-energy collision, such as a motor vehicle or motorcycle crash. Sports injuries, such as a fall while skiing or a collision with another player during soccer, are lower energy injuries that can cause tibial shaft fractures. Sports that involve repeated impact to the shin bones, such as long-distance running. The presence of significant osteoporosis increases the risk for compound or more complex fractures associated with higher morbidity and mortality. Types of tibia shaft fractures. The type of tibia fracture greatly depends on the initial force that causes the break. Direct trauma leads to transverse and comminuted fractures. In transverse fracture, the break is a straight horizontal line going across the tibial shaft. Rotational forces, twisting, lead to oblique or spiral fractures. In spiral fracture, the fracture line encircles the shaft like the stripes on a barbershop sign. Oblique fracture has an angled line across the shaft. A stable fracture involves a crack in the bone that leaves most of the bone intact and in its normal position. This is called a non-displaced fracture. With a displaced fracture, a crack in the bone moves part of the bone so that it is no longer aligned. Stress fractures, also called hairline fractures, are common overuse injuries. These fractures are small, thin cracks in the bone. I will discuss this type of fractures later. When the bone fractures into three or more pieces, this is called a comminuted fracture. Open fractures are fractures where the bone breaks through the skin and can be seen, or a deep wound exposes the bone through the skin. In closed fracture, the bone is broken, but the skin is intact. Symptoms and diagnosis. A tibial shaft fracture usually causes immediate, severe pain, lower leg swelling, inability to walk or bear weight on the leg. Significantly displaced fractures can lead to a deformity or instability of the leg. Bone tenting over the skin at the fracture site, or bone protruding through a break in the skin. To diagnose a fractured tibia, a doctor will ask about a person's medical history and how the injury happened. Then he will perform a careful examination. Open fractures are common and overlying skin should be carefully examined for small lacerations. Severe fractures from high-velocity trauma can be associated with neurovascular injury. Therefore, it is important to examine distal pulses and lower extremity motor and sensory function. Definitive diagnosis of a tibial shaft fracture is made by plain radiograph. The radiographic features help to determine whether conservative or operative treatment is preferred. The anteroposterior and lateral radiographs obtained should include the entire length of the lower leg from knee to ankle. Sometimes the fracture lines can be very thin and hard to see on an X-ray. A CT scan can help your doctor see the lines more clearly. MRI examination is the only method to identify early symptoms of stress injuries, even when a fracture line is not visible. Initial treatment. Initial treatment is stabilization of the fracture is accomplished with a long leg posterior splint. Ice and elevation minimize swelling and along with analgesics, help to control pain. These treatments continue for 48 to 72 hours, or until definitive management begins. Close monitoring during the initial treatment phase must allow doctors to detect any emerging compartment syndrome or change in neurovascular status. Immediate antibiotics should be administered within 3 hours for all open tibia fractures. In addition, tetanus vaccination status should be confirmed and appropriate prophylaxis should be administered if necessary. All open tibia fractures require an emergent surgical debridement within 12 to 24 hours of injury. Definitive treatment. Closed well-aligned non-displaced tibial shaft fractures may be definitively treated with a long leg cast. Certain patients who may be non-ambulatory or those unfit for surgery can also be treated non-surgically. The acceptable alignment criteria are less than 5 degrees varus valgus angulation, less than 10 degrees anterior posterior angulation, greater than 50% cortical apposition, less than 1 centimeter shortening, less than 10 degrees rotational malalignment. Most fractures cause some swelling for the first few weeks. Your doctor may initially apply a splint to provide comfort and support. Once the swelling goes down, your doctor will change the splint to a full cast. A long leg cast is applied that incorporates the knee and ankle joint, thus preventing excess motion above and below the fracture. The cast extends from the metatarsal heads to the upper thigh. The ankle is positioned in neutral with no dorsal or plantar flexion. Knee position allows up to 5 degrees of flexion. Serial radiographs are obtained at weekly follow-up visits to identify any loss of reduction or change in position. The patient progresses gradually to partial and then full weight bearing when an evidence of satisfactory bone healing occurs on radiograph. Most non-displaced tibial shaft fractures heal within 10 to 14 weeks. If long leg casting fails to achieve or maintain adequate reduction, the patient needs operative intervention. Surgery may also be recommended for certain types of fractures, including open fractures, soft tissue injury that will not tolerate casting, fractures that have not healed with non-surgical treatment, fractures with many bone fragments and a large degree of displacement, ipsilateral limb injury, called floating knee, polytrauma, and bilateral tibia fractures. Currently, the method most surgeons use for treating tibia fractures is intramedullary nailing. During this procedure, a specially designed metal rod is inserted into the canal of the tibia. The rod passes across the fracture to keep it in position. The intramedullary nail is screwed to the bone at both ends. This keeps the nail and the bone in proper position during healing. Intramedullary nailing provides strong, stable, full-length fixation. Internal fixation with plates and screws. During this operation, the bone fragments are first repositioned into their normal alignment. They are held together with screws and metal plates attached to the outer surface of the bone. Plates and screws are often used when intramedullary nailing may not be possible, such as for fractures that extend into either the knee or ankle joints. And in tibia fractures in the setting of adjacent implant hardware, for example prior total knee arthroplasty. For polytrauma patients or patients with open fractures with soft tissue defects or contamination, we use external fixation. In this type of operation, metal pins or screws are placed into the bone above and below the fracture site. The pins and screws are attached to a frame outside the skin. This device is a stabilizing frame that holds the bones in the proper position so they can heal. Recovery after surgery. Following surgery, the patient may start weight-bearing immediately or you may require a period of non-weight-bearing using of crutches or walker. This depends on the severity of the fracture and its location. Physical therapy will help to restore normal muscle strength, joint motion, and flexibility. It can also help you manage your pain after surgery. Most tibial shaft fractures take 3 to 6 months to heal completely. Some take even longer, especially if the fracture was open or broken into several pieces or if the patient uses tobacco products. Complications. In the days following injury, patients with tibial shaft fractures are at relatively high risk of developing acute compartment syndrome. It occurs when pressure within the muscles builds to dangerous levels. It is a limb-threatening complication unless the pressure is relieved quickly. The surgeon makes incisions in your skin and the muscle coverings to relieve pressure. Fat embolism syndrome occurs following high-energy trauma. This condition can occur before or following surgical intervention and can be life-threatening. Other potential short-term complications include infection, which occurs more frequently with open fractures and those requiring surgical fixation, and severe soft tissue injury with contamination. Bone infection is difficult to treat and often requires multiple surgeries and long-term antibiotics. Possible longer-term complications include malunion, which occurs when a fractured bone heals in an abnormal position, which can lead to impaired function of the bone or limb and make it look like it is bent. Delayed union or non-union, when the fracture heals slower than usual or not at all. Non-union is confirmed when no healing occurs at 9 months. Patients treated with intramedullary nailing regain function but often experience chronic sequelae, including knee pain, leg swelling, reduced ankle mobility, and thigh and calf muscle atrophy.